Hello, good morning, and welcome everybody to Newthorpe Baptist Church Sunday morning service. Welcome if you're here, welcome if you're there. It's a bit chilly this morning. We've got folk in hats and gloves. I went out this morning to go and see the sunrise. That was my plan. I caught a glimpse of it on my way into work on Monday, and I thought, oh, that'd be great. It would have been a lovely morning to have gone for a walk. I've got a couple of days off this week. I will make sure I get out and I see the sunrise. Went out the next day. Couldn't even tell what direction the sun was coming from. Same the following day. I was then back at work, couldn't go. So this morning, I thought, it looks a bit clearer. I'm going to head out again. And I did. And I went for a bike ride down by Benerley Viaduct. Absolutely freezing. But I still didn't get to see the sunrise. But a cyclist passed me. Just as I was taking a few photos, I might put some up to Facebook later. I was taking a few photos of really sort of icy fields and the trees. And the cyclist just passed me. I'm like, beautiful, isn't it? And I'm like, yeah, it is. So the sunrise is there. It keeps coming up each morning. Sometimes we can't see it. We struggle to see it. But there is the hope of that sunrise that we will see one day, and I will get out to see it. So we're going to come this morning with that hope that we already have. It's not just something that we're looking forward to. We already have a hope in Jesus. So we're going to sing our first song this morning, which is Lord, I Come to You. Let my faith be, heart be changed, renewed. That's what we're after. Yeah.
There are two Bible readings this morning. The first one is from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Jesus predicts his death. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And the second reading is from Romans chapter 7, verses 14 to 25. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So then, I myself, in my mind, am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. God bless this reading.
I realised I've been quite good recently at doing introductions at the beginning, just in case there's anybody watching that hasn't seen us or come along before or happened to be watching us in a month's time or whatever it might be. So, quick recap. I'm Phil. We've got Carolyn, Yvonne, we've got Andrew pushing all the buttons. And although I haven't mentioned her week by week, Val is showing people in through the door, making sure they're all law-abiding citizens and hand gel and all that sort of stuff. So thank you very much, Val. It is appreciated. We're also lucky enough this morning to have with us Peter Grange, who's going to be bringing us our message in just a second. But just a little comment on those Bible readings. If you have got a Bible to hand, Mark chapter 8, verse 31, and Romans chapter 7, starting at verse 14. It's worth having them out around because there's quite a lot in there, isn't it? They're quite meaty.
Thank you so much. And it's a real joy to be back here again this morning to share fellowship with you and worship. Thank you. If any man would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. I really must get myself a new lawnmower. In the winter, I service it. New smart plug, change the oil, sharpen the cutters, and I generally tidy it up, clean it. But after a few months of use, heavy use in my garden in the summer, it starts to misfire. The cutting blades don't seem to work as they used to. And by the end of the summer, the work all needs doing again. Now it's a rather old machine. A new one would probably be very much easier, but there seems something special about keeping that old machine going. But you know, that lawnmower is a bit like me, really. I confess my sins, ask God for forgiveness again, But after a while of use, I find myself prone to those same weaknesses over again. Now, is that something you can relate with? And I think our time of lockdown has exposed some of those weaknesses. However, I do find it extremely comforting to know that Paul in the New Testament had exactly the same problem. As he says in Romans 7, as we have just read, "For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do." That's comforting, isn't it? He knew exactly where we are. So what are we to do with this sinful nature, which we all seem to have and need to recognise we have? It seems to me that we can all be rather like those supermarket trolleys. You push them in one direction, but they go in another, don't they? They have that compulsive desire to go in the direction that you don't want to go. The one that we really don't want to go in. I'm sure you know exactly what I'm talking about. Now this brings me now to the man who was eating his packed lunch at work. "Oh dear," he said, as he looked at his sandwiches. "Sardines again." Now his friend who's sitting next to him helpfully says, "Why don't you get your wife to pack up something different?" "Well, that's the trouble," he replied. "I make them myself." You see, the remedy to his problem was in his own hands. And so it is with all of us. But we do not always see it or even want to see it. It's so obvious to others and can often be something that we calmly turn a blind eye to. And during these times of lockdown, I think it's a time to just rethink some of those perhaps less comforting thoughts. Now, we'll be celebrating the season of Lent shortly, coming up to Easter in a few weeks' time. And that's about self-denial. Perhaps doing without something, maybe some self-indulgent, a favourite food or activity perhaps. Now there's nothing wrong with that, and that celebrating Lent in that way is excellent and to be encouraged. However, we need to grasp that self-denial goes much deeper than that, much deeper. It is perhaps looking at the old lawnmower with its marks, scars, dints and scrapes of many years of use and saying firmly, "That is just not me." If I want to progress in the Christian life, if I want to move on from the old life with its problems, its marks and scars, I must consider that denying myself will always be a significant and integral part of that journey, but one we don't always want to recognise. Now then, this brings me to the young boy who was due to recite a poem at school speech day. He was ushered up to the platform for all to see, and he started very confidently with the title. But then his mind went completely blank, and silence befell the whole hall. "Try it again, young man," an usher helpfully suggested. So the boy again confidently with the title spoke out, but alas, could get no further. All the young boy's family were there on the front row, mouthing the words, trying to get him there. Then a lady on the second row leaned forward and said to the now highly embarrassed boy's mother, "Isn't that your little boy? Never seen him before in my life," came the very stiff reply. The mother completely disowned him in that moment of panic. But the more I think about this, Perhaps this is what self-denial can be about. Denying myself or even disowning that self. I think another way of looking at this is a story of a lady who appeared in a reality TV programme, who successfully lost some 10 stones in weight. Now that's significant, isn't it? And became a very different person as a result. The defining moment of her story and the point at which her determination was kindled was when she saw a photograph of her old self and explained, "That is just not me." But it's also the same for us. When we look at ourselves and our failures, and when we say, "That is just not me," then perhaps we can be considering it progress in the Christian life. Now, I do believe care is needed here, because if that's not me, what is? Now, I think a helpful way of looking at this is to understand that if you go high up on the Welsh hills and observe the sheep there, they do tend to be rather thin and scrawny, as they have to deal with the poorer quality conditions and mountain situation, much harsher. Whereas if you go round to the Cotswolds area and look at the sheep there, they look very much better fed, a little bit more woolly, if you will. They thrive and look better nourished. The conditions we need to look at are the conditions that we accept in our lives and the circumstances that we expose ourselves to. Perhaps you want to look at them and say, "This is just not me. This is just not the proper me." What we think about, consider, and expose ourselves to. Now, I take the view that Jesus is our example, as I trust you do as well. The good news of the Bible is that God sees us all, not as we are, with our weaknesses in sin, but as how we might be in him. We are invited in the Bible to put on Christ. Isn't that lovely? To put on Christ. Now, this does not mean that we should go about pretending to be like Jesus in the way an actor plays a film part. That's just hypocrisy. The kind that Jesus himself warned about when the Pharisees paraded their piety, which is putting up a pretense that they were better than they really were. But they had never really looked at themselves. They were like the person who looks in the mirror and then immediately forgets what they look like. They really did think they were like the part they were playing. And I think lockdown has helped us just focus on what we really are like. Actors often asked if in real life they are indeed like the characters that they sometimes portray. Occasionally they do admit that there is indeed something of that character within their lives. But many times they say, "Oh no, I'm not really like that at all." We can only avoid the hypocrisy that Jesus warns against if we are constantly recognizing and rejecting self with its marks, its scars, its dints, and its scrapes of many years of use, and look to aspire to the person God wants us to be. You see, our example is Jesus. God wants us to be like him. As soon as we look to make Jesus our focus, a different image starts to appear in our lives. The old self is just not me, but the example of Jesus is. Now, I know of a true story of a prisoner of war in Germany during World War II. He decided to contrive his release and repatriation back home by pretending to be insane. However, after many months He managed to do this so convincingly that he was indeed repatriated back home. But the great tragedy was that he had played the part too well, and the balance of his mind had tipped and was committed to an asylum on his return. He had become the part that he had played. We need to be allowing truth to operate in our lives. There is, however, that great truth here that as we endeavour to follow Christ, we constantly try to aspire to the part we are playing. We pray for God's help with this. Our lives start to be transformed. Our spirits become alive and renewed in the likeness of Christ. Now that is exciting, isn't it? What a way to come out of lockdown. Now as we approach Lent and Easter, they remind us so vividly of the temptations Christ suffered on the road to the cross. But we cannot realistically expect our lives to be much different as we deal with life in this sinful, fallen world. Our old self has to be crucified and face a relentless battle with temptation. But over the last months, a number of restrictions have been forcibly placed upon us. But it is essential we see the challenges and trials we pass through as opportunities for God's love to work in our lives. New freedoms potentially await later this year. But what will we do with those freedoms? As the book of James says, we can use these circumstances to see ourselves more clearly and say, that is just not me, or turn our gaze towards Christ to become what he wants us to be. Do not be distracted when things go badly and think that God does not care for you or love you. He does. He deeply cares for you. And he deeply loves you. But we must learn to manage sin and slippage. That moment of temptation, pause and get into the habit of praying and asking God to help you. That's how we resist the devil and see him flee. Remember, God sees us not as we are, like that old battered lawnmower, but as we can be, when his grace and power and his Holy Spirit have indeed transformed us. Remember, God is working in you if you invite him and let him to turn our lives into something very precious in his sight for eternity. God bless you. Thank you.
I cried because I am tired. I cried because some people don't do what they are supposed to. I cried because I want to do my job well, but I'm the only one who does my job. I cried because there is so much to do and I can't do it all. I cried because we don't have enough staff. I cried because I want to help the amazing nurses. I cried because they are all broken. I cry because patient numbers on ITU have doubled. I cry because my house is a mess, but I'm too tired to do anything when I get home. I cry because 2020 was so difficult for me, and in some ways, particularly with work, it doesn't feel like it's over. I cried because I know what is coming. And most importantly, I cry because that's okay, and I had a better day because of it.
Okay, we've been asked this week to pray for the NHS. It's going to be a nationwide thing that everybody's been asked to to pray for the NHS this week, and maybe in your prayers this week you could keep the focus on our NHS. That was a young lady called Louise, who's in a Baptist church down south. I think Andrew just started it a little bit late and it missed off the who she was. Her name's Louise, and she works in ICU. So let's pray for the NHS. Lord, during this pandemic, we pray for healthcare workers at all hospitals up and down the country, for nurses, doctors, administrators, ambulance workers, anyone who works within the NHS, we lift them all before you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, receive the pain that NHS workers feel as, despite their best efforts, they watch countless people die. You are the God who heals the brokenhearted. Help to shield their hearts from undue pain. And when this pandemic is over, let those shields fall easily away. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, who sustains the weary, be present with those healthcare workers as they speak to the dying on behalf of loved ones they've not met and do not know. Place your words on their lips so they might speak your compassion, your wisdom, your patience and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be with those healthcare workers who have to work with the fear of the exposure to the virus. Remind them that you are near. Clothe and protect them with your love. We think of those workers who are sleeping in garages or at work or in hotels, just out of love and concern for their own families and that they don't expose them to the virus. Attend to their weary bodies, Lord, and give them rest. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. But most of all, Lord, we ask that you fill and sustain all healthcare workers with your strength, that they might have the stamina to work whatever shifts are required of them. Keep them close to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
One of those weeks again where a few things are kind of fitting together where you thought they might not necessarily have fit together. Peter expanding on the readings, talking about wanting to be more than we are at the moment, that sort of element of, I know there's things I do wrong and I keep going back to those wrong things and I want to be better, but I'm not at the moment. The nurse talking about crying about being upset about not being able to get home and do the tidying up because she was so tired and all those sort of things. And there's, you may have heard the sort of like little phrase particularly popular on social media, but people say it anyway, just saying it's okay to not be okay. You know, we are not perfect. We are striving to get there, but we do need to be authentic at the same time, don't we? We can't pretend everything's feeling wonderful and great when it isn't, but we still do have that hope. You know, we can be, as another little picture I saw recently was, we can be both a masterpiece and a work in progress at the same time. At the risk of introducing an extra read into today's today's proceedings. Philippians 4. I'm not saying this because I'm in need, for I have learnt to be content in whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learnt the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Now, personally, I can say I'm probably not quite there yet. I'm still not quite content. I want things to be a bit different. But, as Peter was saying, there are things that we have learnt, perhaps we can learn about ourselves, about having to cope when things aren't as great, you know, where things are a bit more challenging. So, yeah. If you're watching online, go back, listen to it again. Let it sink in. We've just got one more song to sing. Your cross, your cross, it draws me to your heart. And then I'll be back to do a short blessing at the end. So wherever you were when you came today, whether you're here in person, whether you're watching at home, whether we're taking part, we ask, Lord, that you bless us all, that you give us strength for today and the week to come. and that we know that we are loved by you. Amen.